Are you able to see? Not yet, I guess. Is my screen has come up?
Not it, sir.
One second. Why is it not coming? Yeah, got it. Share content. Screen. Yeah, here you go. Okay. All right. So we were doing people and also power skills in terms of leadership over the last four sessions. And this area, way of working. Okay, we thought our audience are regularly hearing. So probably we can take a slow step. And then when the turn comes, we have to do it. When we look at it, agile and hyper-agile. Actually, first time I heard about this topic in my life, hyper-agile. We had many other hypers. Okay, we talk about small children is hyperactive. Okay, so in Christian terminology, there is something called hyper-grace. Okay. So in many times, it is positive as well as negative connotations, this word hyper. And then I asked my wife, what is the meaning of hyper? And she said, it is a superlative. Okay, high, higher, highest. Okay, now if it is a superlative, high, higher, highest, why hyper? Okay, so then we thought, okay, there is no other word beyond superlative, so they use the word hyper. Okay, hyperactive, okay, and many other hypers. So what is this hyper agile? Then I tried, reached out to one of our very known faculty peer member, asked him, can you deliver this topic, hyper agile? And then I received a response saying that I am busy. I don't see any foreseeable slot in the next few months or so. So I may not be able to take it up. So then I thought, okay, conventional agile, predictive is all very quite familiar to our people. We have to crack this. What is this hyper agile? So then I thought, okay, let me do some literature. And then I found two important pieces of information. One from PMI as part of Citizen Developer Program, and the other, there is one Congress presentation white paper, and which was very quite informative. Okay, so upfront, so dear colleagues, my apology. Okay, this is not my own material. People have done some good work, and I found it interesting. I thought I'll give due credits to the inventors and then share this so that tomorrow they also benefited. Okay, so I picked up the keywords, printed the flyer and circulated. And when I start preparing, I found it something very familiar tone. Okay, the first one is the definition itself. It interested me. And then, of course, yesterday I spent about, I think, close to 3 to 4 hours, okay, to prepare this. And I found that very, very interesting. And not much work has been done on this. In fact, initially I thought I will bring scaled agile, PMI's disciplined agile, also part of it when I looked at the definition and the alignment. Then I decided, no, okay, we will not do that. We'll just focus on one thread of hyper-agile and allow the participants to debate, discuss, share. That's how we'll take it. We'll not put too many things and all. So that is the outcome. You will not be surprised, because at the end of the session, you know that, hey, this is something we have been doing it. Some of you may familiar, or some of you may think that this is something I know it already. Only thing, industry and PS put a new jargon around that. Okay, so it's going to be new. It's going to be familiar. But some of the companies that practices are not familiar. Okay, so that we will discuss that. That movement started long ago. When I say long ago, maybe 4 or 5 decades back they started. And now this Agile community is trying to hijack it and then put it under some bucket and then try to sell it, or maybe not try to make money out of it. Okay, so that's a small intro, how I chose this. And maybe at the end of it, provinces may even jump into it and then do consulting on Hyper-Agile. And some of you who are audience here may even volunteer to take it further to learn, deep dive, contribute, and go for it. Because we see in many, many organizations, a pure Agile showed early results, but they are struggling to sustain it, number one. Number two, non-IT organizations, they want to adapt, but they don't find the right consultants or implementing organizations. Because all the current methodologies in one way or other revolves around IT. Okay, so a pure pharma company or a manufacturing company or a construction company, when are facing challenges, because the moment you bring IT software development into it, they feel sick. Okay, don't get offended. This is something sometimes we face in the market when we talk to them about Agile. Let me not take too much of time and then jump into it. See, some of these things, no? Not my own words, it is author's words. So you may not really accept it because usually for the purpose of stressing their theme and points, they overemphasize, and some of the other alternative themes they will undermine. Okay, so both sides are not correct. Okay, undermining some of the conventional practices and overemphasizing. It is to stretch, it is there in every industry. Okay, every industry, every domain, including poets and others. Okay, it is always their points. They will give a highlight, bold, and others try to make it in a small font. Okay, and do that. So you see on the left side, it talks about conventional enterprises. Okay, so the typical definition is they are hierarchical, standardized, a strict division of work based on functions, and a lot of barriers between those who organize the work and processes, define the processes, and those who execute the processes. Okay, so this is what he characterizes as conventional enterprises. And then comes the other side. You see here in today's world. Okay, so the new age enterprises, they face turbulent, uncertain, complex. They find it difficult to plan and execute because the future is constantly evolving, changing. They must pivot both rapidly and reactively to seize opportunities, quickly and reactively to seize opportunities to in order to maintain the market position. This requires an ability to adapt, change ahead of competitors, and adopt operational models to support that. So 19th, 20th century is the history. Now we need to leave them behind. Okay, so as the times are left behind us, and we also need leave these things. This is not a new thing that I am reading or opening. Everybody is facing it. Okay. I guess anyone who don't accept, probably you can raise your hands and then say what you are having in mind. Okay, if you want to take up for discussion. Throughout this topic, please feel free to interact, because it is a very nascent early stage concept and it will evolve. So we can criticize, we can debate, and we can also take away some key elements which we feel good for us. Okay, let's come to the definition part. Typically, if you look at it, Agile, okay, it evolved largely from a projectized environment. Okay, because if you look at Watts Humphrey, okay, he wrote a book in 1980s, I guess, okay, around software development, the perils and other things, and then he also came up with a beautiful concept called PSP, TSP around CMM, but Agile hijacked and then ruled the market subsequently. Okay, so Agile is largely confined to a project, though in the recent past, maybe the last 10 years, it is taken up into a program solution level and then to the enterprise level. But again, okay, it embraces little bit of DevOps, little bit of operational side, but largely we can say that it is around projects and programs. Okay. Now, this author, okay, at the end, the last slide, I kind of gave the credit to the authors who brought this. Hyperagile seeks to drive an agile culture further beyond the walls of any one product or project, embedding it into the organizational DNA. Okay. So that is hyperagility. So the scaled agile and the disciplined agile, they speak about it, but the architecture practices don't actually speak about it. Okay, I attended a disciplined agile session and also wrote the exam as agilist. The first 45 minutes, the author spoke in length about these things. But the rest of the 13 hours, it was largely talking about IT, security, this, that, all of them. Okay. But I would say probably, say 40 to 60%, they are close to hyperagile, not more than that. Okay. So here the words are good. Seeks to drive agile culture, okay, further and beyond the walls of any one project or product, embedding it into the organizational DNA. Now, again, at the end of it, if you say, according to this definition, do we have a definition? Detailing, structure, practices, tools, techniques? Okay, you'll be thoroughly disappointed. No. Okay. And I believe it cannot be done also. Okay, it has to be done by the respective organization with some catalyst consultants or advisors supporting. So it has to evolve from within, not from outside. Okay, so hyperagility is an ability of an enterprise to adapt to the complexity and turbulence by being nimble, innovative, reactive, and agile. Okay, now carefully notice the word reactive. Okay, we always say, even from Stephen Covey's 7 habits, the first habit is be proactive. Okay, so now here he says that the world that we foresee and changes that we come across, how do we balance between proactive and reactive? Okay, So that is the keywords that characterizes hyperagile. All right. Yeah, this is just at the cornerstone, the definition. Maybe anyone would like to comment on it. Some of you may be more knowledgeable than me. As I told you, I'm a kid. Okay, I just know this word only the last few weeks or so. Anyone would like to comment on the definition?
Sir, I'm Reggie.
Yes, Reggie.
So my question, so I am not from this IT sector. I am a non-IT guy. But still, I have a question like Agile. What is the difference between hyper-agile? It is mentioning hyper-agile, that is project embedding into the organizational DNA. So Agile also it's the same, like it is embedded into your organizational DNA. Why we are telling hyper-agile is only...
Okay. So if I want to put it this way, conventional or the methodologies around Agile in the market are more project-centric. Hyper-Agile is organizational-centric. Okay? So it is not project-centric, it is organizational-centric.
Okay. So you mean that it is based on organization, it will change?
Yes, exactly. That is why I said it may be really difficult to define a methodology around hyperagile. Mm-hmm. Okay, even a framework around hyperagile. We should see, maybe in the coming years, this will catch up and more buzzword will come around this. And probably you can say that I'm an early runner, early adapter, early one to know about hyperagile.
Okay.
Anybody else?
Sir, the focus will be more on the delivery part. It doesn't matter whether who the teams shall be involved. So as you said, there are no balls. Earlier, there is a distinction, clear distinction that the project teams need to deliver. But it is for the organization to deliver the product or whatever the end goal. And it also makes sense to collaborate with anyone who is relevant to the delivery of the product.
You use the word, nice word. Okay, it is beyond the walls.
Yeah.
Okay, now, if you look at disciplined agile and scaled agile, all others I won't compare at all. These two we can compare. It's like prison walls. Okay, there are too many walls with a lot of cells and floors or sections around. Okay, so we cannot say that it is beyond the walls. So here it's a beyond the walls. In fact, if necessary, we have to construct the walls.
I remember one interesting quote from one of the movie Tintin movies. I think most of the people have seen. Captain Haddock says, if you hit the wall, push the wall.
The wall will open up, is it?
If you hit the wall, push the wall, he says.
Okay. That's right. Okay.
Sir, my understanding about, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, we are able to hear you.
Okay. So my understanding about the hyperagility is transforming from project to the organization. Now, presently, organization is adopting Agile or hybrid or predictive or waterfall, depending upon the project. Mm. So same organization can deliver, they can choose any life cycle for their new project. But now the entire organization is transforming into the Agile. So
correct.
The organization is behaving like Agile organization now. That's what my understanding is.
That's right.
Hyper-agility is organization is transforming into the agility mode. So then probably any type of project which they're going to take up in future, probably they will adopt agile methodology or life cycle to execute more customer centric or at the end of the day to satisfy the customer needs.
That's right. Okay, only one correction. You said any kind of project. Okay, now we need to drop the word project. Okay, any kind of activity, whether boardroom centered activity or operation centered activity or support centered activity or project centered activity, okay, they will think Agile.
Yeah, so Agile will become a philosophy of the organization.
That's right. So it looks like together we are learning much more than what is there in the slide.
Sir, the focus on the keywords, what you have mentioned in the below, nimble, innovative, reactive, and agile. But earlier the observation was to be proactive in an organization.
So you see that the opposite words.
Yeah, correct.
Okay. Nimble, so for that, opposite is strong. Okay. Innovative, the opposite is unshakable, predictable. Reactive, the opposite is proactive. Okay. And agile, I do not know what is the opposite.
No, here the key thing is to be a proactive, we need to do a lot of planning ahead and park some resources and plan for the resources to be available at the right time. But you are saying reactive. So the philosophy could be there. Let us see. Let us address it when we get there. Let us cross the bridge when we get there. But in that context,
Yeah. So Ramana, you're opening a dangerous topic.
No, I'm really, really fascinated by that word. Why reactive has come here?
Yes, sir. Yeah, coming to the same word, sir, I'm also parallelly thinking. Actually, most of the times we are proactive as far as when projects are concerned. Okay, that's how we address all impediments, whatever, the risk management, everything will come like that. But in reactive, when you are adopting agility, how come reactive is there here?
Okay.
The entire organization is becoming agile, that transformation is going into the agility or agile mode. Then why reactive? It should be always proactive, no?
Okay. Let's
so to address the challenges. Yeah.
And then keep going. I'm sure we'll find solution. Okay. All right. I invited a couple of special people to this. One has joined Mr. Lakshmi Narayana Kodipathi. Okay. So who is a veteran in Bonn, in Microsoft, and he's now mentoring a lot of young minds in startup world and others. So welcome, Lakshmi. And so I want you to pitch in where required with your thoughts. Okay. So let's keep going. I would like to conduct...
Hi, Shimas. I have something to add to that. For the conversation which was going on to the reactor. I come from Dr. Reddy's, which is a research-based organization. And if we remember, if you go back to Pimbok, we utilize agile methodology to unpredictable projects or processes. And to give example from a research-based organization, we just can't be proactive. It depends on the previous result. It goes along the way. We have to see, because we have never done it before, we do an experiment, see the results, and to react to it. The plan changes on the way, on the go. There is an increasing embracement of agile methodology even in lab environment. And I feel that is why it is reactive and proactive. In places where it is so unpredictable that you have to be reactive and you can't be proactive. That is some of my thoughts there.
Okay. Good. Yeah. Thank you very much. Even I am from operational background, my original experiences. So in an operational situation, proactiveness, actually there is not much of room. Okay, plant is running 24/7 and every parameter to be watched. Okay, so we need to see some kind of a signature trend. Okay, and then immediately we need to respond to it. So when we say reactive, to what we react, when we react is the question. Are you allowing it till the fire catches and then react? That is bad. Okay, but if you are sensitive to what's happening around and when that reversal signature is seen in the bar chart or the trend graph, okay, so then you, if you react, then you will see that you avert a big disaster or you harvest a big opportunity. okay, in a business world. So I think probably that's what they will mean. Now, in a conventional organization, for that to be traced and then translated into strategy and then moved into an initiative and then come back to the shop floor to be a project, usually takes months and years. Okay. So now the question is, are they reacting proactively? Are they reacting firefighting mode? Okay, is the question. So usually they take their own sweet time, and towards the end, basically, it is unavoidable. Okay, so that is, I think the other Lakshmi says we are attentive and then act on it. That is reactive. Okay, that's what he says. Okay, I'm so happy. A lot of reactions coming up. So now I don't need to worry about two less slide and then what am I going to do till 8:15. So you will engage the session. Let's go forward. Let's do a quick survey. All of you, please, learn to react with thumbs up, Roman voting, okay? Or agree, you can clap or whatever it is. Those who agree only should respond. Others, please keep quiet, okay? And I would request Ratna to count, okay, and then give me the result. Okay, well, how many people are doing it? Okay, but please, I think around 20 means all Provi audience also, you are free to respond to this survey because these questions you do not know. Okay, I coined only today. All 19 of you or 18 of you should respond. The total should come to 18. Nobody should vote twice. Okay, then it will become a one. So let's start. I'll ask the first question. I work with passion and feel a profound connection with my company. I drive innovation and move the organization forward. Move the organization forward. Okay, not the team, not the department. Okay, you are a prime mover of the organization. Okay, when I say passion, I work with passion. You understand the word passion, okay? You give anything for that, your company. How many of you are working like that or worked like that for your current organization? All right. 1, 2, 3, 4. Six. If you want to remove, you can remove. If you want to add, you can add. A couple of them answering Priyadarshini, KV Ramana through chat. Yeah. Vijay Vamana. Thank you, sir, for joining. Okay.
Sir, whoever has answered, I have to keep your hand.
Just count. Oh. No, don't personalize it.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I want only the count. Okay. So currently I'm seeing 3 plus 3, 6 plus 1, 7. Okay.
And 2 in chat, sir, 9.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, survey is closed. Okay, 9. I'm going to, you can please put down your hands. And so that I'll turn my second question, okay. Yeah, Vijay Vamana. And yeah, good. Thank you. Second question. I work, but not with energy and passion into it. Okay, so this is the second. Okay, yes, I do my duty very sincerely, committedly. I am loyal. Okay, but I don't give my life to my company. Okay, so this is the second category. I think that I appreciate Vijay. You are very genuine. Please don't take it the other way. And K.V. Ramana. So it is three, Reggie.
Okay. Sir, it's a contradictory statement.
Contradictory, don't worry. Okay. this is not going to your company or to your home.
Sir, will you share this with as performance appraisal or what?
Please, don't think so. Okay. Let's take it as three. Okay. Even though some of them have dropped. These are very embarrassing surveys. People don't raise their hands. Okay. Right. So let me go back to the third question. So 9 and 3, third question. I'm unhappy at work. I put a mask acting as if I am busy, acting as if I'm adding a lot of value. So this is how my work is. Okay. I'm sure many of you may not raise your hands, but internally you will be raising your hands for yourself. So I don't know how to count. Okay. If I ask one-on-one, I'm sure at least 10 out of 20 will give an answer to this, along with the beautiful reasons and how to do that. Otherwise, there cannot be 10%, 20%, 30% attrition in the organizations. Okay, so if you look at from a 3-year cycle, 10 to 12% per annum amounts to 30, 40%. Okay, whatever could be the reason, somebody says it is not me, it is the environment and various other factors. Okay, but at the end of the day, this is the result. Okay, good. So I'll put it this way. Out of 20, if I leave myself, on two end accounts, 18 people. Out of 18, 9 comes as category 1, 3 comes as category 2, and probably 9 plus 3, 12, another 6 comes under category 3. Okay, so you may not agree, but let's take it. Let me go to a global survey. Okay, somebody has done this exercise. It is published. It is open for everyone to access. You see here, only 13% of the employees are engaged. Okay, they work with passion, feel a profound connection to the company. They drive innovation and move the organization forward. Okay, it is 13%. Okay, 63% are not engaged. The word engagement, please underline that word. Okay, they are not engaged. They are essentially checked out. They are sleepwalking through their work day, putting time but not necessarily energy and passion into their work, 63%. Now, 24% are disengaged. They are not just unhappy at work. They are busy acting out their unhappiness, through various means. I just use the word mask and cap or whatever it is. Every day, these workers undermine what their engaged co-workers accomplish. They are not only distracted by themselves, but also distracting others. Especially those who are engaged, the first category, 13% category. Now, I don't know. Probably these set of 20 audience are very, very creamy layer, outliers, because they are all certified PMPs and very passionate, doing great job in your organizations. So that could be one very, very solid reason. You are all outliers. If so, I'm so proud and happy about you being our alumni. So we are serving a very, very elite community. But what about this survey outcome? This is not my survey. This people, Gallup survey in the year 2013, not long ago. It is not a very age old. So any, do you agree? Do you disagree? Partly agree? Any of you?
Well, if I can share something, sir. I think the way it is framed can be misunderstood. I'll just give an example. So when you're asking about people, are people are passionate, give their best, people can say yes. But then when we say, okay, well, are they driving the innovation to an organization level? Maybe the answer there is no. You know, so it indirectly seems to kind of convey that only people at an enterprise level responsibility are or can be engaged, which I think is not right. You know, it can also be people who are passionate can actually go above and beyond their call of work and take initiatives, which can be at a team level or at a project level or may not be at an organization level. So I think the way the words are framed is, or way the question is framed can also kind of influence the outcome. Okay. So I think it is a question framing issue.
So what the call is saying, okay, what the survey outcome gave is also true. What this survey presented here is also true. Correct, Carl?
Yeah, you can interpret it that way. Okay. You kind of gave it a positive.
Let's listen from somebody else. Okay, maybe if it is possible, Gudipathi, Lakshmi sir, can you speak? Okay, otherwise anybody else can also take it up.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Actually, just to add to what Carl said, so only 13% of the employees are engaged at work, but there are two sentences in that. And even in the first sentence, they work with passion and feel a profound connection. So these could be exclusive things. Again, this question is framed in a, you know, way which is not really, it can be interpreted in different ways. So I was to not raise my hand, but then I was like, okay, one of them I do and another one I don't do.
Okay. Now, let me comment because I think it is very interesting. I would like to cover all the scope. If you look at it, many of you said this. Okay, the first part is true with many people. Passion, feel profound connect, but they may not be able to drive innovation and move the organization. So now, the problem is not with the employee. The problem is with the boardroom and the governance and many other things. So they are tying them so much, okay, they are not able to be a prime mover of the organization. Now that is where this hyper agile plays an important. Okay, so when for example is hyper agile, even a worker, okay, a shop floor temporary worker can be a prime mover for the company. Okay, I'm sure many of you would have heard this story, a textile mill story. Okay, one day the supervisor come and said, asked the worker, okay, please break the floor here. He said, sir, the floor is too good. Why do you want to break? See, I'm here to command, you are here to answer. Break. He broke. And then he couldn't get anything. And he moves a few feet away. And then say, you break here now. He breaks. And then nothing happens. So he almost damages 4-5 places, beautiful places. And then finally, that worker gave up. Sir, I can't do this anymore. Please tell me, why are you asking this to do this? Then he also got frustrated. He feels, he need to open up. And he said, I'm just trying to locate one pipeline. And he said, sir, I know where that pipeline goes. I carefully kind of opened it up because the pipeline should not be damaged. Okay. So it is there. He goes and immediately shows, if you open it here, the pipeline will be there. So now who is the prime mover of the organization? Is it the supervisor or manager or the worker? Okay, it is the worker. Okay, so now the hyper agile organization will come and say, hey, you have been here right from the day Bhumi Puja was done. You know everything about this company. I just joined a couple of years back as a CEO or whatever it is. Okay, I'm so happy that you are a veteran in this company. I have this problem. Can you suggest where it runs? Okay, so much of damage could have been avoided, and that guy would have been a thrilled employee. He would have got the best of his entire career having talked to, given a suggestion to that. Okay, that is this 13% of the employees. Are you with me? Okay, so when I looked at it, I feel this is a reality today. Okay, 13% are engaged, 63% are working for the company, 24% are disengaged. Okay, there could be variations. Let's not get into it. We'll move forward. Shall I? Okay. Yeah, Vijay. Okay, thank you, Vijay. Thank you so much. Okay, let's go. So what motivates today's employees? Okay, I thought I'll do a survey, but we are going pretty well. And let me show it to you and then ask for your comment. Okay, performance-based salary increases. Okay, which is very, very common. Almost 60-70% of the companies follow. Annual bonuses, maybe another 10% of the companies follow. Okay, occasional hangouts. Now that has become norm of the day, thanks to a lot of resorts and then board employees. So that's also happening around, thinking that they are motivated through that. And uncomfortably celebrating a milestone with colleagues from the shop floor. Okay, sometimes it happens. Okay, how many people really celebrate that milestone achievement standing in the shop floor? We don't know. But this is an observation. So do you agree employees are really get motivated like that? Especially the first two categories. Engaged.
It is not. Huh? Not always, sir, because they also look for the recognition of the work world. Mm.
Okay. So these but are if all, you look at it today, I don't know, a 10-year experienced person in information technology is drawing 4 lakhs per month, 10 to 12 years experienced.
Yeah, these are all extrinsic, Srini, but you know, what matters is maybe the intrinsic motivators. Now that will probably drive the innovation and then passion rather than these extrinsic motivators.
Okay. So we agree that employees are not motivated. We also agree this poor fact that all companies competing each other, giving these things to the employees, thinking that they are motivated. They are getting motivated. Okay, I think there is no exception to it, whether it is a startup or a renowned multinational. All of them are doing this. Okay.
For the freshers,
I think who is speaking, Dr. Venu or? Yes, Venu. I think the other person's background wise.
For the youngsters, the freshers, they get motivated.
Yes.
To more work, but for the experienced people, it really doesn't impact.
Impact. But organizations practice the other way around. Okay, they basically pour it on the 3 years to 20 years. And when they found that this 15-year, 16-year is not living up, okay, so mercilessly, they ask them to go home. Okay, that's what is happening, is it not?
Yeah, true.
Okay, now what really motivates, I think you already answered. Okay, this goes a little further. Freedom to operate, number one. Freedom to innovate, number two. And independently drive results. Okay. And fourth one, a collaborative culture and a customer or market-centric environment. Okay. Now, I guess these four words are very, very carefully selected. Freedom to operate, freedom to innovate, allowing the freedom to independently drive results and a collaborative culture and customer-centric environment. Now, these four factors truly motivate employees and make them, okay, that the 63% of those people to get engaged joining that 13% bandwagon. So that makes the 80% of the people engaged. Now, you may immediately think, how is it possible? Can it happen, a company which employs some 300,000 employees? Okay, a very big question, a very, very truly, okay, such question will come and we don't have an answer. Okay, but you will find an answer at the end. If you have such question, please hold on. Any other comments? I guess, do you all agree? What truly?
Yeah, essentially, it boils down to autonomy. That is, yes, where I think all these four points are talking about.
Yes. Autonomy. I think we have to infuse an entrepreneurship spirit from a daily wager to a management director. Freedom to operate, freedom to innovate, independently drive results, and a collaborative culture, customer-centric environment.
Sir, I have a question about this. For the big organizations, they have the structure to follow.
Yes.
So everyone is coming and I'm saying, okay, I'm going to innovate, I'm going to operate, I'm going to work independently to get the result. Then when a multinational company, they have their own agenda and they have their own projects. So okay. If in that case, then I think it's not possible for everyone have the chance to do that.
Okay. Now, tell me the textile story, what I said, is it not possible for that worker to operate freely, operate innovatively, independently drive result, having a collaborative culture, all these four data points, is it not possible to apply to that daily wager or rather contract worker or person at the lowest in the organization?
So these are applicable only when the person is experienced, he is traveling with the organization for longer time. Definitely what you said is right, because he's having a knowledge of the, you know, the flow and know where the pipeline is running. It is the best way to ask him only. But a person who is joined, just joined.
Now, think differently. Okay. A person who has joined will have a lot more passion, or a person, yes, with 20 years experience have more passion.
No, here passion is, you know, subject to, sir, because that we need to infuse or we need to create that kind of passionate environment by organization. We have to create that environment to the employees, whether it is a just starter or the senior most in the organization also. We need to create that environment by choosing these four, what you have already selected, no, sir?
That's correct. But I can tell you, a CEO can create that environment right in his first speech on the induction program, or even he can go to the college campus and then create that in his one pitch speech, he can do that. Okay. So it is not necessary that the employee should have 20 years of experience. In his first CEO speech, when a youngster here in his campus only, as part of a recruitment, this can be done.
Yes, it can be done. Huh? Yes, yes.
That's what I'm trying to say. And as a nimble, let's say, fresher, he will not go and meddle with anything just like that, because you are given the freedom, because he know the what can go wrong. So basically he will be only listening to somebody on his own how to go about. He will not abuse or misuse the freedom that is given to him. Only thing, we think that they might get into do on their own and then get into problems. So we put a lot of ifs and buts, structures and other things, and then curb their freedom to innovate and freedom to drive results.
No, not necessarily required. Yeah, we can give that freedom in the beginning itself, as per the organizational, the philosophy as per them. As per that, we can give that. So they can also adapt and they can try to innovate or creatively they can put their efforts.
Then you are hyper-agile. That's it. I'm not talking about a hypothetical organization. Towards the end, actually, I'm going to give you list of organizations they do that. Okay. So we are not just talking in the air, but can an existing organization with a few 100,000 employees do that and all? Because we have inherited a huge legacy, which are contradicting to all these things. So it is like making an elephant to dance on a small chair, stool. That is very difficult, actually.
So I just want to...
Yes, Vijay.
Please go ahead.
Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, sir. So I just want to bring in a couple of points. So I think there are some organizations, more so from the product organizations where I've worked, they are not into a kind of very hierarchical structure. Rather, it's a flat organization. It's a kind of flat organization, more so in terms of, operating and the way we work, the kind of freedom we are given. It's just a kind of deliverables we drive and that we own for ourselves. For example, if there is something that we have to deliver for tomorrow, we would do it in a couple of days back. And also that we find the hierarchy only more from the leadership or visionary point of view. And we have seen there is a lot of diversity, inclusion, belongingness. We call it as DIBS, basically. So that kind of a thing is pretty much there. And it is right from, they do not differentiate between a new, even if it's a trainer, a new person, they are given mentor buddy to grow. But then the kind of inclusion and inclusiveness is seen. And, their achievements are recognized. It's because... if it's individual and if it's as a team, they are recognized. This is something that I have seen, and the kind of the free to and the freedom to operate. And if you are very in any way innovative, and that adds to the way results are put up, then we are pretty much encouraged. Yeah, so I've seen those. Actually, I worked with one of the organization, and I should share my
observation. I'm so happy. I'm telling you, that organization is hyper-agile. Okay, I'm so happy that you shared it. And there are, maybe few hundreds or even thousands of organizations are there, across the world who are hyper-agile. Hyper-agile organization, they do not say that they are hyper-agile. In fact, such organization, they don't even want publicity. Okay.
Absolutely. The way they perform, the way they, the culture itself speaks a lot about it. So.
Exactly. Okay. I'm so thrilled, Vijayalakshmi, for bringing up this point and solution. So those organizations are hyper-agile. In fact, we need to call them. Okay. They don't call themselves as hyper-agile. Okay. Good.
Sir, here... I would like to share one experience about the senior workers, what you are telling. So what I feel is a context or the situations need to come for them to be contacted. For example, in our organization, what happened is there was a problem in the production line, the filling of the vials. So there frequently they are toppling and the number of vials was going wasted. So one of the senior persons was involved in the operations. He was invited, was called and asked to give his observations. So he said that the particular angle in which the vials were traveling, he tweaked on that and the problem was solved. But for him to contribute, there is a context which needs to be arise. Yeah, so he cannot simply say that, he cannot volunteer and say that I will do this. Correct. People may not pay serious attention to him also. Yeah. But he needs to prove himself once the chance has been given. And the same gentleman was involved. When they were finalizing the orders for the other vial filling machine, he was involved in doing the factory acceptances and give his observations while the machine was being tested during the fact. So what I feel is the context should come for them to contribute. In the example, earlier example, what you took, where the worker was asked to break the floor at certain points to identify the pipeline or whatever it is. So the worker was sure. he has a before knowledge, prior knowledge, where it lies, mm-hmm. either through by virtue of the drawings, whatever he has may come across, or by himself getting involved in that activity. So it may not be always like that. He may also, some of the items could be reactive also, the contributions mm-hmm. From the senior workers.
Okay.
That's what I would like to
say. Nice. Thank you.
Sir, my observation, because I am coming from pharmaceutical industry, so I have worked in different multinational companies, because we always encourage people irrespective of their seniority and all, even for freshers also. Oh, we give liberty to experiment in the field, actually, when we are promoting our products to the the doctors or paramedics or wherever we go and approach to the clients. So we encourage by seeing the talent of each individual, looking at their capabilities, understanding, while recruiting them into the company, we'll come to know. So these people are we don't put any rider over there. So we allow them, because we give the framework to them. This is how we need to work. But within the framework, we will allow them to experiment and creative thinking or whatever innovative activities. We always encourage that. That is the reason why the moment you say the hyper agility and all, I'm able to recollect my the day-to-day operations and all, because these are more or similar in our day-to-day profession.
That's right.
So
okay.
There is no senior junior differentiation here, but while selecting itself, we will come to know the capability of individuals and all. But as such, the pharmaceutical industry run on this like this only.
Correct.
So yeah, I think the hyper agility is already embedded
there. Yeah. So I'm so happy all pharma and others know. So you feel already hyper agile. So when someone talks about agile and its greatness, you can simply say that we are hyper agile. Okay. Let's keep going.
Not to deviate, but the last slide, we should treat it as an extension of the Maslow hierarchy. I mean, certain things are still required, some kind of recognition before we come to the the self-actualization stage where there is independence and freedom.
Yeah.
So they shouldn't be missed out when we're talking of things which motivate today's employees.
That's correct. Yeah. Okay. So in fact, I would say these things are a bit of extension and other things of Maslow's and Hertzberg hygiene motivation theory. Yeah. Okay. So what are the characteristics? I think we are fully getting into the groove. I don't want to spend too much time on these terms, because we all understand, most all of us are in the same page. Okay, the characteristics of hyperagile organization: trust and accountability. Okay, so you trust them and give them freely the accountability that due for them. And the reactivity or proactivity. Okay. Now, we had enough discussion on that. Let's look at it in that context. Okay, so we don't need to be a hyper proactive plan, nuts and bolts, everything upfront to be there to get signed off, and then only it should start, and you have to go according to what has been defined. So we don't look at it. Okay, so we say that yes, there is a blueprint required, but we should always be open in terms of aligning, realigning, adjusting, readjusting during the course of action based on the attentiveness and the triggers that comes from the market and the environment. Okay, since we had a lot of discussion, we'll move on. Probably this is very important. Okay, this as well as the next. Okay, both are closely related. Top down versus bottom up. Okay, which also goes in terms of pyramid versus inverted pyramid. Okay, now this pyramid versus inverted pyramid actually was brought by 1 minute manager. What is his name?
Ken Blanchett.
Ken Blanchett.
Ken Blanchett.
He brought that pyramid versus inverted pyramid, top down versus bottom up. Okay, so the role of top-down, role of bottom-up, okay, the increased freedom, participation, collaboration from the bottom-up, and the top-down, okay, more of supporting, acknowledging, appreciating, okay, and aligning. Okay, the pyramid versus inverted pyramid, I put it this way. A leader or in the person who inspire, okay, he basically comes with a kind of facilitating the visioning, okay, facilitating. Again, I'm not saying this is my vision, it is not like that. Facilitate the organization to cast the vision and then go down to the bottom of the pyramid and then allow the people to be on the top, customer front-ending and all. Give them the freedom to be accountable and go forward. Just say that, okay, now that these are done, you guys drive. Okay, if you face any problem or if something goes wrong, you come to me. I will go back and face it. Otherwise, okay, it is you. You are running the show. Okay, so start with top-down pyramid approach. And then once that the initial work is facilitated, go down, okay, as a servant leader. Okay, so these are, in a nutshell, characteristics of hyper-agile organizations. We have seen it, okay, based on what the stories we discussed and the examples have looked at it. Okay. So let me go forward. The four dimensions of hyper-agile. Now, you'll see, now we are actually zeroing down to our own familiar terms. So it starts with strategic agility, portfolio agility, project and program agility, and operational or operation agility. Okay, so the agility is there in the DNA of the organization. Okay. So that is that. I think probably you all might think that it is a punctured balloon. Okay, you might be expecting something magic happening, but PS is settling back to what he knows. Only thing, he added a word called agility. So please don't think that this is not mine. As I told you, I am only a spokesman of a couple of genius who spoke in some international conferences, submitted a paper, etc. Okay, let's look through it, what it means. Okay, the strategic agility requires a strong mission statement and the stakeholders who commit to the organization's purpose. Okay, the organization selects only strategic and related innovative opportunities. They are very choosy, okay, that helps them to reach the goal. It is like a predator patiently waiting for its prey. Okay, they don't simply take up everything that falls on their plate. Okay, they see that there is a niche for them and it won't go anywhere else except them. And they wait for it, do it. And they align the complete organization to that purpose. Okay, so they have a purpose statement, mission statement, more than a vision statement. Okay, and then that is defined as strategic agility. And the rest of the things will follow. Portfolio agility is all about being rapidly reallocate resources to strategic initiatives that have the highest potential of value creation and customer delight. Okay, so you may be willing to keep people for many months on bench until you get the right project and do it. But do it so that nobody else will be able to do it. Okay, so they are very responsive to the market requirements and give the highest value creation to the customer delight. Program and project agility is all about being able to move forward in a turbulent environment when they don't know in advance what's ahead in the future. When changes might come from the project clients as well as from the complex okay, the technical environment. Okay, they are not afraid of turbulent environment. They know that they can navigate through that. They are completely ready for turbulence, reactions, nimble, all that. It is there in their project and program agility. Operational agility, ability for the organization to seize cost-cutting as well as revenue-enhancing opportunities faster than competitors by trusting employees to make their right decision. Okay, again, I worked, I think, about 6-7 years in an operational agility, agile organization. I can actually speak volumes. My MBA thesis is on this operational agility. Okay, before I even know the word agility. Okay, so they do anything, okay, to maximize the revenues, cut the cost. They are given freedom. We have just heard from Ramana about an employee giving an important suggestion to choose complex equipments and improvements. Okay, so these are the four dimensions. When you see this slide, many of you can say that I am working in such hyper agile, or you can say that I can run a company with that hyper agile. It could be anything, but hyper agile is all about these four dimensions. I really wanted to convey this to you before I take another caselets and a new jargon called hidden giant, which will come after. I'll just pause here for a few minutes. I think the discussion is going so good. I'm afraid whether at 8 o'clock, whether I can finish. Probably I might take 15 minutes more, 8:15, if you all are okay with it.
Sir, these four dimensions, what you spoke about in this slide, I think most of them were implemented by the organizations who were delivering this COVID vaccine. Then the race was who will be delivering the first and who will be getting the approval and who can capture the market. So that race we have seen earlier. All the COVID vaccines that were produced, they were produced at risk. Means they will be released to the market only if we get the approval. If they don't get approval, they lie there.
So, you are right, Ramana. It makes me to little bit generalize it. When you are forced and cornered, in Agile we see impediments. What is that? The last one is blockers. Okay, when you come to a wall,
approvals, whatever.
Then organizations automatically either they turn hyper agile or they perish from the corporate landscape. We have seen it, and that what you say is very true. In fact, I saw even a couple of case studies how COVID forced organizations to become agile, especially both IT and non-IT sector. Vijay, would you like to add something?
No, sir. Nothing at this moment. Thank you.
All right. Okay. I'll keep going. This I thought we should really address and discuss. This hidden giant actually is not something very new. If you go to Wikipedia and then search for hidden giants, they list around more than 100 organizations in Germany. And a good research is done around those companies, and a lot of literatures are available. Now they are connecting the dots. These hidden giants are hyper-agile organizations. Otherwise, this word and these organizations are quite historic. And I have not brought in except a few attributes. I would encourage all of you to go back and read more about these hidden giants. Let me read it for you. conventional organizations, due to their size, large nature, have numerous blind spots. While often continually focusing on market trend, financial indicators, competitive data, and other important trends, they often overlook the hidden giants. Okay? I mean, we could see the conventional organizations, they do all these things. The hidden giants are lean companies, incubated and born in a hyper-agile state. They have focus, clear strategic goals, superb talents, and fresh ideas. Okay, I've just captured only few things in these two slides, but the case studies actually talks more. Okay, let's look at the persona of hidden giants. The first one, I don't agree. Okay, less than 5 years old, but lot of organizations have joined this bandwagon over the last 5 years. Probably that made them to put this word. But otherwise, hidden giants are there for few decades. They're hyper-agile. They're initially staffed with the top talent from various SMEs. Okay, the highly talented. Maintains presence in popular urban areas, at least to begin with, you see them. In other places also we see, but they are kind of in sublime in nature, whereas urban side, they get opportunities to come up, okay, and become a giant. As often open office floor plans, very collaborative in work, okay, they don't have any strict dress code, and they practice something called holacracy. You can search and find out. I have one display on what is holacracy. That is the organizational model they follow. They don't focus on too many. They focus on few key products and services, but they make sure that they are niche in their market, in their segment. Okay, generally, they are not overpopulated. Okay, less than 100 employees. Okay, so this is a kind of a survey around these hidden giants. But this is bringing into hyper-agile context. Without hyper-agile, there are a lot of giants, especially, okay, the strong German economy is because of these hidden giants. Okay, they were all once ignored, but now they are a big threat to some of the big multinational companies. Okay. Let me also go further with this one, how they operate. Okay, the holacracy versus hierarchy. The holacracy takes powers, traditionally reserved for executives, but they distribute it to different employees based on the role, their competency, and their zeal, or whatever it is. Okay, you cluster it and give it to them. Okay, you just be a servant leader, okay, for them to actualize their thoughts and other things, funding and etc. Okay, so there is a super circle, there are some sub circles, and there are certain individuals. So you encourage everyone. You see, some examples are given in marketing, in digital advertising, social media. If you identify somebody is too good, give them the freedom to operate independently, but at the same time, aligning to the overall organization purpose. You don't need to teach them organization's purpose because they know it is in their DNA. Okay, so they basically understand and appreciate. Okay, while the traditional hierarchical, you all know that. Okay, CEO, upper management, middle management, supervisor and staff. Okay, that is not there, which is becomes a cluster and individuals. Now, are the hidden giants, are they threat to visible giants? When I say visible giant, in terms of size, in terms of turnover, in terms of market share, they dominate. Okay, so there are hidden giants, they don't have anything of that. Okay, for many organizations, this company would not seem as a threat to begin with. Okay, they'll just brush it away. Okay, they are so big. What can they do? Okay. However, While the large organization is distracted by normal operations, existing methodologies, the hidden giant could be a laser focused on one of their key product area. Perhaps one of their strategic goal is to become number one in a market covered by a larger organization. Okay, but they don't really publicize it and do all that, but their focus, everything is into that laser focused key strategic product. Okay, and they're not worried about competition. And sometimes they know that they'll be there in that number one slot one day. And they don't really run after that. Okay, their focus is on their key competency, laser focused. This is the last slide in terms of hidden giant. Okay, how do they become super giant? Okay, firstly, they are leaner. Their capability to quickly surround strategy with actionable plan is organic. Okay, it is not inorganic, it is organic because it is in their blood. The entire culture is collaborative, shared around common vision. Their speed, quality, marketability of products that can hit the market from hidden giant can be disastrous for a larger company, which we are seeing it today in some sectors. Once a product or service is released, rapid growth, market disruption may cause the large company to realize enough revenue loss to cause stakeholders to respond in kind. But even if the large organization wants to change quickly, it is often not feasible because of their innate operational model. They are simply not nimble. Okay, that's how we see, okay, some big elephants fall because they are not able to respond, and these hidden giants become giants. Okay, I'll pause here for all these five slides, hidden giants, definition, persona, holacracy, and are they threat to big companies? When do they become threat? And actually, when do they take over the big company?
Sir, coming to me, in fact, I worked for this kind of hidden giant company. In 2000, in 1995, I started my career in pharmaceutical industry. Subsequently, I joined with this kind of similar company. I grew along with the company called by name Novo Nordisk. Novo Nordisk was not known to many, among pharmaceutical fraternity, because these were the company actually discovered insulin for the treatment of diabetes. The knowledge level and understanding of the usage of the product was very, very, very minimal. I'm talking about 97, 98, that period.
Novopen, okay. I think.
Now it is Novopen, because I worked for that company right from the day. Actually, the initial team was not even 100 members in India. I was the 120 employee, actually. So from there, now it is more than 1,000 employees. That is a different story. What I'm trying to share with you is this hidden giant actually became a big giant and gave a big threat to the major companies who are dominating the market in oral pills. Mm. Those who are treating diabetes with oral tablets. So actually they have changed the entire treatment modalities after introducing this insulin concept, for which they underplayed for so many years. They didn't expose themselves as a big company to the world. And they actually done their groundwork with very sharp lasered focus at real targeted area, where we need to educate and whom to educate and what is the benefit out of it. These things we have done for so many years. So that's how actually this hidden giant, now it is a become big giant and giving tough competition in the diabetes treatment segment in the Indian pharmaceutical industry. Now I'm talking about after 24 years. So this is what I'm just correlating my experience from there to here. So many phases we underwent, and we have done very very, very focused activities, focused communication patterns, and no, our strategies were very, very targeted to the required people only. So when we were talking about our company and a product also, so many even other fraternity also not even aware what your people are really doing. So many people were not even aware what is the activity we are doing in the field. So that's how my experience in working for a niche company to a big major company. Now it is a world's fastest growing top leading company called Novo Nordisk now. So this is what my experience in from, I think this is a hyper agile company. My experience is like that because that's it's right. A flat organization in the beginning.
Yeah.
Now there is a huge hierarchy and all.
Yeah.
Okay. This is what my experience.
Excellent. Yeah, excellent. Thank you so much. And it is so refreshing. I'm sure even half of you here will be able to identify one hyper agile hidden giant in you. In fact, after reading this caselet and preparing this, I realized that my first petrochemical company, okay, which is about to be a bond sick and about in a ICU baby in the first 3 years. Today, it is a giant, okay? And when I looked at this four dimensions of hyper-agile, okay, agile in strategy, agile in portfolio, agile in operation, agile in project and program, I tell you, we did this for 3 years, okay? Everything, every department will do innovation. Okay, whether purchase or finance or operation or maintenance. Okay, and the strategy is laser focused. We have to turn this organization around, make it viable. That was the only goal. And today, I think probably that in the whole Asia, they are the highest manufacturers of that one chemical. Okay, which was, I think, 20% of its capacity almost 25 years back. Okay, 25 years back factory, today it is running 5x capacity. They are hyper agile. Okay, and there are many, many hyper agiles. In fact, it would be nice if some Indian consulting organization do a study on Indian enterprises as well, both for profit as well as not for profit. Okay, it will be a big awakening and a huge contribution to the corporate sector if someone studies that. Okay. All right. This is a big list from Wikipedia. I have given the link. You can go and look at it. You will see a lot of companies based in Germany. And they have given a lot of analysis. Okay. It was done by, I think there is a HBR. Okay, Harvard Business paper on this hidden giant. Okay, if time permits, you can go and read it. Very nice. I think I have captured it in my reference also. You can look at it. Now, how an existing organization, okay, can transform to hyper-agile? Okay, to tell you the fact, it is not possible. Okay. They should not, I mean, I don't know whether they can really attempt it or not, okay? But, okay, if they want to become hyper-agile, okay, they need to only benchmark these organizations and say that I want to think like them, I want to change like them, I want to become like them, okay? So it should not be the days where I am looking at, let's say, an IBM or like that, giants, and say that I want to become one day like that. I think the triangles are being inverted. They need to look at okay, hyper-agile, mid-sized companies, and they need to say that, how do I become like them? How do I change like them? How do I think like them? Okay, so that is the okay, transformation strategy. So think like them, relook at the strategy, relook at communication, collaboration, layers, etc. Change like them, you have to change the culture. Okay, find the true north, that is where are you Okay, that is the true north, as is. And then create work streams. Okay, work streams is in alignment with what I said, this organization type, holacracy. Okay, create work streams, empower them, and rebuild with a proper agile portfolio, project program, and operational management. Okay, so in fact, Provinces has all these keys. So after preparing this presentation, I feel that I'm really tempted to get into hyper-agile consulting. Okay, become like them. Say, having turned around, having become hyper-agile, it's only starting. Continually change, continually innovate, because disruptors are born every day. Okay, so you just cannot stop. But this hyper-agile organizations do not chase the wind. Okay, if someone overtakes and then go, they don't bother. Okay, if someone has more name and fame, they don't bother. Okay, they don't want to be in the limelight. So if you look at good to great Jim Collins, okay, he will talk about level 5 leadership. So he will say that this level 5 leaders don't really want to talk about themselves at all. They are very introvert. Okay, this, I think the same thing I'm extrapolating to hyper agile organizations. If you ask them, hey, how you are so laser focused, they'll ask, is it? Am I laser focused? Only when you say that, I'm thinking, yeah, it might be like that. Okay, they may not even understand. Okay, so the new iron triangle is no longer scope, schedule, cost. I think that's gone long ago. It should be executive leadership, pruning the portfolio to the highest value added, listening to the voice of the customer and employee. Okay, so that seemed to be the new triangle. If all these three things join hands, and hyper-agile is a positive thing. So this is from this, primarily from this paper. It is a PMI Global Congress 2016 paper. I have given the this one citation, and also that Giants, okay, that is also the HBR article, and the Wikipedia link also is there. So I encourage, okay, all of you to go through. So for this, you don't need to go to certified Scrum Masters, Product Owner, and Scaled Agilist. All these things are not necessary. Okay, you can become a hyper-agile directly. So that's the story for the day. I guess I asked you for 8:15, and we have another 6-7 minutes. And Ratna, you can post the feedback.
Yes, sir.
And I'm sure many of you have something very interesting to share. In fact, I feel sometimes I feel even Provinces is a hyper-agile company. Okay, not to boast ourselves, but we want to be, aspire to be. Okay. Yeah, open.
You don't know you're already comments. In. You don't know you're already in.
All right. Thanks, Vijay. Okay. Great. Any questions from anyone? Please feel free to register your feedback, improvements. Maybe we will take it up further. In your remarks column, maybe you can express your interest to do more on this topic. In case we want to do some work around that, we can actually add you as part of the stakeholders and volunteers. Yeah, I'll stop talking. Please feel free to unmute. And then you can speak.
Hi, sir. Greeting everybody. Thank you so much for this presentation. So I have a quick question to you and everybody else here as well. I've worked in an investment firm and then a business accelerator and in a consulting firm. Our role is mostly to kind of look at startups who are doing some innovative solutions, working on some innovative solutions, and see if there's a large corporate who's got a challenge and see how we can merge that. how they can basically co-create that. So it's like the middle path between, it's not R&D which is build, it is not merger and acquisition which is buy. What we were doing is the middle path, which is to co-create. What I've actually seen is we have worked with different, let's say, agile organizations or organizations who call themselves agile. And the challenge which I've kind of seen there is like, when you work with startups, they work at a different speed as compared to large corporations. And there's a big shift in terms of, you know, culture, structure, and a lot of dynamics which needs to come into the picture. There are quite a few organizations working in the space in terms of, you know, investment firm or management consulting firms, but very few that I've seen have actually successfully been able to integrate this across different industries, so to speak. So my question to you is, while Hyper Agile seems to promise this, do we have, let's say, case studies which integrates that in an effective way? I'm talking from a internal, structural, cultural point of view. I mean, Germany is one. I'm just kind of looking at an Indian context. I know there are a few who are doing some studies like Zinnova and others, but most of the studies actually external facing, which is, you know, what is the startup doing and what is the corporate doing? They're not really focusing on the internal because that requires a lot of probably confidential information as well, which the corporates would not be willing to share. So just want to quickly understand, how do we kind of address this? Because one aspect which I kind of see as a little bit of a challenge is the aspect of sense making. You know, how do you make sense when the change is happening so fast externally? And then how do you manage internally, which is quite slow, which is usually my counterpart from the client side, who has this challenge of grappling with both sides. So any insight or pointers on this would be helpful, please.
Okay. I'm sure many would like to respond, probably for want of time. Let me just look at it. Thanks, Carl. I think there are a lot of hyper giants and hyper-agile organizations in India, as much as we find in Germany or other developed countries. In developed countries, they are hyper-agile and they become global. And they have kind of 60 to 80% global market share against their products. But if you look at it, India as a country, so we can say it's a good subset of the global. So we see a lot of companies here, okay, truly scaling up, may not be crossing the border. Probably that may not be their focus or anything. Probably I can quote a company like Nirman. Okay, very young guys, mid-30s from Bits Pilani. Okay, today they do social services, which I think more than 100 crores. Okay, very nimble, no big structures. Okay, that CEO, for example, if he sees someone, he touch the person's feet and he gives respect. Okay, such a kind of people, and they do great work. Okay, now like that, I think I can keep adding. But why these startups, not everyone become hyper-agile? Okay, you can see from this iron triangle itself. Okay, startups, if you look at it, many of them, they are proud of how much funding they got, more than the proud of the specialty of their product and how it adds value to customer and other things. Okay, so their eyes are not on the delivery excellence or the portfolio or the humble servant executive leadership. Okay, so they're, I feel sometimes they are very, probably even professionally arrogant about their product, technology, and its value. But they are very keen on building their funding round A, round B, round C, make it quickly a billion. And we know that we are reading it, a lot of edutech companies and other things. Okay, so I don't think they are hyper-agile. They are hyper, but not truly 360-degree agile. Okay, I think this is a very long discussion call. Probably anybody else have any other observations? Okay, because otherwise it will actually will exceed the time. Others who have not spoken yet, please I encourage you to share your thoughts. I see some new entrants like Shyam Kumar. And yeah, thanks Vishwanath for sharing. Priya has not spoken much. Praveen. Okay, I'm not forcing you. I'm just giving you a window.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, if there are no further questions, I think it is time up. I will stay back, not a problem, but I don't want to force you to stay back. This is a very new topic. I'm a virgin speaker for this particular topic, first time I have touched this. So I look forward to your active, suggestions and areas of improvements. Please,
sir, here, one last observation. While you're doing some process maturity for the organizations, consulting work, can we inbuild this into that?
I think, Ramana, it's a good point. Okay, we should add this as a small subdomain and then put down a few questions. Yeah, that's a good observation. While we are discussing, I would like to also inform you. We are going to have one interesting webinar from a child specialist from CMC. Okay. How you can be application of talent triangle in parenting. Okay. For all young parents who are future parents. Okay. I'm also very keen to listen to it. He's going to touch parenting. In terms of way of working, power skills, and the other third domain. Okay. So I don't know. Maybe we may do it in second week of December or early January. Okay. Please look out. If you come across, please subscribe. Okay. It's a very, very interesting. My good friend. And it will be nice from a very contrast speech from a person. Okay, a doctor specializing in child, this one, and talking about leadership and power skills. Okay, thank you. Thank you for all those who are patiently waiting, and your participation and your feedback. As part of Provi team, I would like to extend my thanks and good weekend.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Have a nice weekend.
All right.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot, Shyam.
Welcome, sir.
Kishore, thank you. Venu, Dr. Venu, thanks for all the insights.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I want to talk to
Sir.
Lakshminarayana. Is it possible?
Our Lakshminarayana.
Yeah, we.
Sir. Yeah.
Which Lakshminarayana?
He's our participant, sir, who cleared actually PMP.
This is me, sir. Yeah, probably.
Maybe, Ratna, you can pass on Lakshmi's number to him.
Dr. Venu, I will give you his number, sir.
And
he has given his number in the chat. Yeah.
Oh, right.
You display it again, Ratna? So that's
sir?
Now that number you can display.
Number he has given in the chat, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks to everyone. Thanks to everyone.
Thanks, Lakshmi Narayana.
Thank you, Srinivasan, sir.
Yeah. All right.
Ratna, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Kishore sir, you are able to access the feedback form, sir, now?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
Ah, okay, sir. Yeah.
I'm able to now.
Yeah, sure. Kishore, you put a question now, Kishore.
Yes, sir. So okay. I mean, I see a challenge in surviving that culture, sir, because if super giant companies are going to be a competitor for the big player market, right? Obviously, they are going to take over those companies. Right, and they can be part of the all the big players again, right? And again, we will see the same hierarchy.
Yeah, that's a very interesting point. Okay, so if a hyper giant choose to be a giant, organically or inorganically, and if they are not having that laser focused strategy and listening to voice of customer. That all needs a different ball game. So ideally, they should not be willing to become giant. Do you see what I'm saying? Organically, they will grow. Okay. But as they grow organically, okay. Even though they become giants, I feel such companies will not lose their focus. They'll just take it as things come. Okay, they'll be their growth will be very organic, and such companies can go 30, 40, 60, 100 years also. I feel. It's a very, very, very very practical question, and hidden giants have to carefully work on it. Okay. Sometimes probably they may choose.
I mean, there were so many companies exist in the market. They are no more. I mean, they were under IBM or they were under someone else, right? I mean, Sun or something else, right? So,
that's other danger. Okay. So, if a hidden giant, they may not even willing to sell themselves to big giants. Okay. But big giants, will be hunting to acquire those hidden giants. That's another battle, actually. Okay. Thanks, Kishore.
Thank you, sir.
Manikavalli, here, Priyadarshini, ma'am. Kishore, sir?
Yes, ma'am.